If you're into military history, tanks, or even just video games, you might have heard of the IS-6. In War Thunder and World of Tanks especially, it's certainly a pretty scary vehicle to come up against. But I'm willing to bet that you know very little about this Soviet heavy tank. I mean, from the name, you can assume it comes somewhere between the IS-4 and the IS-7, two other post-war Soviet heavies, but it doesn't. In fact, it came before the IS-3, with the entire IS-6 program existing before the war ended. The IS-6 was developed as early as 1943, following on from experimental vehicles like the Object 244, 245 and 248, the EKV project, and Object 701. It was a highly classified vehicle, so secret in fact that the Soviet government and military were kept almost completely out of the loop. But today, in this video, I'm going to take you through all the weird and wonderful aspects of this bizarre vehicle and try and shed some light on a tank that has been shrouded in mystery for the best part of 80 years. This is the IS-6. If you've not seen my IS-2 video I put out a couple of weeks ago, I'd recommend you watch that first, as it gives a lot of context to this mess. But if not, I will give a quick recap. There's a lot of different aspects of the IS-6 I feel I need to explain, but I'll start with a name. Objects 244, 245 and 248 were attempts to increase the firepower of the IS-2, with doubts surfacing about the performance of its 122mm D25T gun. These vehicles were built by the men of Factory No. 100, an experimental tank design bureau. Object 244, following on from the IS-2, was, naturally, known as the IS-3, and mounted a high-velocity 85mm gun, the D5T-85BM. The Object 245, IS-4, mounted the 100mm D10T, and the Object 248, IS-5, mounted the 100mm S-34. The IS-3 was rejected. This left the IS-4 and the IS-5 vying to be crowned to the USSR's next heavy tank. The internal layout of the IS-5's turret was flipped in an attempt to increase the rate of fire, with the commander and gunner moving to the right and the loader on the left. This means you can tell them apart easily by the location of the commander's cupola. Long story short, the IS-5, Object 248, was chosen, and was set to go into production as the IS-100. But letters between three of the top designers at Plant 100, Malyshev, Beria and Fedorenko, revealed that there were pros and cons. The IS-100 had more than double the rate of fire of the IS-122, up to 8 rounds a minute. The tank was half a ton lighter, it had more space inside the turret, and boasted higher penetration. On the flip side, the D25T was performing well against enemy armour, especially as German armour quality dipped. The reduced gun calibre would mean worse HE performance, and a gun of that calibre firing that rapidly would cause a build-up of fumes inside the tank. And so, the IS-3, 4 and 5 joined the original IS-1 and IS-2, Objects 233 and 234, in the Factory 100 reject pile. But, as they say, 6 times the charm. And hence, the IS-6. This is the original document signing off on the IS-6 project, dated April 1944. The specification called for a tracked vehicle weighing up to 65 tons with a crew of 5. The armour needed to withstand incoming fire up to and including an 88mm projectile going 1500 meters per second. The armament was set to be a 122mm gun with a rate of fire between 4 and 6 rounds a minute, with 20 degrees of elevation and 5 of depression, along with one 7.62mm and one 12.7mm machine gun. The vehicle should be able to carry 35 to 40 rounds of 122 ammunition, a couple thousand rounds for the machine guns, 25 hand grenades, 27 signal flares, and 12 smoke bombs. Oh, and it should be able to drive at 40 km an hour, with the ability to go up an incline of around 35 degrees. But the IS-6 was not the only heavy tank on the drawing board, it had competition. It's an incredibly messy story, but basically, both the IS-3 and the IS-4 were already in development at other design bureaus, so Factory 100 was really up against it. The men at Factory 100 were meant to be modernising the IS-2, while the team at Chelyabinsk worked on its successor. This was less than acceptable to Kotin, the man in charge, and slowly work sort of just died out on the modernisation programme. On April 18, 1944, the military representative at Factory 100, a man called Vovk, wrote this letter to his superior, Comrade Markin, reporting strange activity at the factory. Vovk writes about discovering a guarded room that he was denied entry to. When he asked about this, Kotin claimed it was his personal office. In reality, this room was occupied by four of Kotain's sharpest engineers, who then claimed it was merely a smoking room. Vovk then says that it's evident the factory is conducting work that is being hidden from him. He talks about how a new machine gun arrived almost a week ago to mount on the IS-2, and nobody has even started to work on it. The office, the smoking room, the Chamber of Secrets, it was all a cover for the IS-6, a program that Kotain was very much not meant to be working on. But the ego of the men at Factory 100 was a large one, and they weren't about to be beaten by their rival's design. The project was ambitious, but by August 1944, the men working in the secret rooms had their drawings completed, and they worked on making them a reality. Partnering with the men at TSNII-48, an armor research institute, in order to finalize their ideal armor layout, and soon switched from a cast flying saucer design like you see in the very early drawings and models, to a highly angled welded construction known as layout number 15. This hull armor layout was extreme. The front plate was 100mm thick, angled back at 65 degrees, the cheek plates were 100mm angled at 62 degrees upwards and 40 degrees backwards, where they met the 100mm side armor, itself angled at 45 degrees. Even the rear plate and cheeks are angled at 60 degrees, with 60mm and 75mm of armor respectively. A full-scale wooden mock-up of the new vehicle had been completed in one of the bizarre secret rooms of Plant 100, and was the first time a complete IS-6 had been assembled, albeit not a functional one. Now the men had to go develop and test all the parts required to make it work. Firing tests against mock armor layouts in September of 1944 proved that this armor was indeed tiger-proof, with the KWK-43 unable to penetrate the frontal armour of the vehicle even from a distance of just 50 metres. There were issues with the armour cracking under sustained fire, however, and the armour, like all Soviet tank armour of the period, was still prone to cracking along the weld seams. While work continued on the armour, work was also underway on the new suspension system. You may have noticed that in all the drawings, blueprints and mock-ups, the IS-6 would use a new suspension, one that utilised much larger diameter road wheels than that of the KV or IS series, and it eliminated the need for return rollers. These larger diameter wheels would, in theory, allow the tank to be considerably heavier while maintaining decent off-road capabilities. Here are the original blueprints for the new road wheel assemblies, which were 750mm in diameter. The list here shows all the parts needed for the assembly, and there was still a large push to use existing components, so only 7 components were new, while the rest were brought over from the existing IS tanks or even the KV. They didn't yet have a vehicle to put these road wheels onto though, so adapted an old prototype, Object 244, to the task. It wasn't quite long enough for all 6 of the large road wheels to fit, so the last one was a smaller diameter IS type design. At the top of this vehicle you can see cast iron weights, as the suspension needed to be tested under the estimated final combat weight of around 52 tons, not the 46 tons of the IS-2. The new road wheels were put to the test between August and October of 1944, driving just under 1900 kilometers on a combination of cobble, dirt roads and mud, and they work well. There were some issues due to the use of weaker IS series components, but these were soon reinforced and the defect seemed to disappear. So, suspension and armor layout were complete. It was decided to use the V12 engine, the same that was being used on the competing Object 701, rated at 700 horsepower. Kotain and his team also had a trick up their sleeve, with plans to make the IS-6 one of the most mobile heavy tanks of the era, but we'll get into that a little later. With the engine, hull and suspension sorted, we just need a turret and a gun. The turret takes influence from both the IS-2 and the rival Object 701. The turret itself was cast, with 150mm of steel on the front and sides, and 100mm on the back. The roof of the turret had a large bolted plate, which allowed the gun to be removed out the top of the turret rather than through the front, another feature borrowed from the Object 701. The gun in question is a heavily debated topic. The planned gun was likely the BL-13, a high-velocity 122mm gun with this distinctive muzzle brake, a gun rammer and a fume extractor. In reality, this wasn't yet available, so mounted instead was the D-30T, a modernisation of the D-25T, which had the same performance but was apparently lighter and more compact. With all the components finally complete, a prototype could be assembled. This is the Object 252. And was the first IS-6 to undergo tests in November of 1944, and immediately a whole host of issues were found. In their quest to make the IS-6 invulnerable, the designers had made the decision to neglect crew comfort and ergonomics, and thus it was a miserable vehicle to operate. The gunner didn't have his own hatch, the commander and driver's visibility was poor, and the driver had his head pressed directly against the sloped frontal plate the entire time. and the issues didn't end there. The average speed was only around 20 kilometers per hour, and the problems with the suspension returned with a vengeance. Over 820 kilometers of testing, 14 road wheels had to be replaced, with each lasting, on average, only around 200 kilometers. Around 65 kilograms of force was required to operate the gearbox, which heated up to over 100 degrees during operation. It was a disastrous result for the men at Factory 100, especially when the Object 701 was proving itself a reliable fighting machine over at Chelyabinsk. In November, a modernized IS-6 was proposed, known as Object 252U. It incorporated a novel pike nose, making the armor even more effective, and allowing the driver's hatch to be moved to the top of the hull, rather than being on the plate itself. A similar design was put forward for the modernized IS-2 project they were supposed to be working on, known as IS-2U, and drawings of both were sent to Moscow along with the completed Object 252. This proved to be the death of the IS-6 program, when government officials decided to instead further develop Kirovets 1, a vehicle that would eventually become the IS-3. Kirovets 1 wasn't as revolutionary as IS-6, but it was well protected and much more reliable, so that was that. At this point, the IS-6 itself may have been rejected, but work continued on the design, in the hope that elements of it could be used on a future project. Here we can see the poor Object 244, mounting the BL-13 gun and new road wheels, which were larger and stronger than those that failed so spectacularly on the Object 252. Work was also underway on an exciting project, Object 253. This was, essentially, identical to Object 252, but used an electromechanical transmission, or EMT, which would, in theory, provide a number of benefits. Better traction, fuel consumption, agility, and braking performance. Soviet engineers have been working on electromechanical transmissions since the start of the war, and these efforts had only been accelerated when they examined captured Ferdinand tank destroyers and discovered that the Germans had been working along similar lines. This is the EKV, a KV-1S modified with an EMT, which was completed sometime in 1943, but deemed too heavy and too bulky for service. The ESU-100 was a similar project, but was instead a modification of the failed SU-100 M1 tank destroyer. The ESU never got off the drawing board, but the Object 253 did. In fact, the wooden model of IS-6 we saw earlier actually has a mock EMT in the rear, seen here. The actual Object 253 was only completed in around November-December 1944, after the IS-6 project had already been canned. You can see the layout here. The engine would turn the generator, which would then, through a series of batteries and more generators, power electric motors that would drive the drive sprockets, allowing fine tuning of the speed of each track without a clunky gearbox. Object 253 was built primarily to test the transmission, so they didn't bother with the large diameter road wheels that were causing so many issues on Object 252. Instead, they opted for the suspension system of the IS-2, keep things simple. The 253 was almost 3 tons heavier than the 252 at 54 tons, highlighting one of the key drawbacks of using an electromechanical transmission. Some sources say the tank was tested late in 1944, while others claim it wasn't tested until spring of 1945. Either way, it was a disaster. Object 253 made it exactly 10 kilometers before the transmission burst into flames, overheating under the stress. After the fire was put out and the tank was repaired, the rear plate was replaced with a simple steel cover, mounting an additional fan in an attempt to cool the vehicle. But it was too little, too late, and the trials of Object 253 were stopped soon after, leaving the IS-6 a complete failure, especially considering the relative success of the Object 701 and Kirovets 1. However, aspects of the IS-6 would live on, and soon Comrade Vovk would send yet another letter, complaining that Kotin and his men were back in their secret rooms, working on yet another project, one that I'll be talking about in another video, the Object 260, or IS-7. I hope you've enjoyed this deep dive into the bizarre story of the IS-6, Factory 100, and Comrade Kotin's secret smoking rooms. Please do consider subscribing if you haven't already, and remember to join the Discord for more tank goodness. Thank you to all my Patreon supporters, and I'll see you guys in the next one.